can or airbrush? Rattle can, airbrush. Airbrush, rattle can. Rattle can, airbrush. Or can? Hey everybody, Dr. Cranky back with another episode of the Cranky Show. So today we're going to talk a little bit about rattle can or airbrush. Rattle can, airbrush. Airbrush, rattle can. Rattle can, airbrush. No. Rattle can, airbrush. Rattle can, airbrush. Yes. These are your two choices for the most part. Even though, you know, if you're building Warhammer miniatures, you don't need either one of these. You can do it with a brush. But we're going to talk specifically about painting and working on models. And so, and this might be more than just one video, more than just one part. So we'll break it up if it gets to be too long-winded here. That's why they call it rattle can, because it's got a metallic ball in there and it rattles. And this is a great line, by the way. One coat lacquer. We've been using them lately, and we love them. But you know, the old trusty airbrush. This is my Iwata Eclipse HPCS. It's a workhorse. We've been using it for years, loving every minute of it. Now, the thing is that when you're going with rattle can, you know, to do a shiny paint job, and that's mostly what we use it for. You could weather your models with rattle can, but over time the thickness of the paint is going to start to obliterate your detail. So I don't recommend it, even though, you know, you could do it. You want to stay in scale. So, but we're talking about, right now we're talking about building, you know, painting shiny models. And so rattle cans comes into play. You can also do shiny paint jobs with your airbrush, of course. But, you know, we're really going to start talking about the difference between shiny and weathered and or ratted the way we like it here in the laboratory. It seems to me that there are two different kinds of paint, ways of painting. When you do shiny, and you can watch Don Yost's amazing videos. He's got two great videos on how to paint shiny using enamel and enamel cut with cheap lacquer using the airbrush. The objective is to, of course, paint as quickly as is humanly possible, in part because you want to avoid, like Don says, inviting Murphy into the shop. You don't want to have any problems. So normally you layer in your few coats, tacky coats, then you do a couple of medium coats, then finally you do your glossy coats, and then you put the body under cover so that you don't get dust on there. So it seems to me that the objective is to paint the body as quickly as possible and then let it gas out, and during that time you could probably build some other aspect of the model, you know, clean parts, get the engine ready, that kind of thing, do the sub-assemblies. But it seems to us that the objective here is to paint shiny as quickly as possible over a short period of time, even though, you know, the beauty of Don's system is that by cutting the enamel with lacquer thinner, you cut back having to wait for that paint to gas out and harden by a whole bunch of days. But you know, you can avoid that by using the airbrush as well, and get some very good results using House of Color, etc., etc. Now, when you're doing weathered, the objective is not so much how quickly you can paint the model, because you could paint the model just as quickly over a weekend. But the process of it is going to slow you down, in part because you're using this other tool. Not to say that, you know, the nozzle on these won't clog up. But, you know, the airbrush requires a change in colors and all of that. Also, if you're going to weather the way we weather, which is adding layers and coats to a paint job so that, you know, you achieve different effects, whether you're using salt or some other thing. It requires a little bit more time. And it seems to me that for those of us who are addicted to that process, it really stretches out the enjoyment of it. And that's why we do it. But you see, in this case, we've jumped between doing shiny and now doing a different kind of weathered, you know, by using metallizers. And we're starting another project, which we'll show you here shortly. But, you know, in my mind, that's sort of the difference. When I'm working with rattle cans, I want the paint. I want the whole thing to be done. If I start in the morning, I would like to be done by the afternoon. That way I can put the body away in a safe place, dust-free place, and let it gas out over a period of a couple of days. Or if I'm using House of Color, then overnight is plenty of time. But with the airbrush, I like to take my time and I like to see the effect as I'm building it. And I think it's sort of the process of building these layers that you achieve the final results that you're after using using the airbrush. And so that, you know, it's something that I wanted to talk a little bit about, and probably the conversation will continue onto another video. But you know, take your time. In either case, take your time, follow through. You know, you've got, by now you've got good instincts and you've got good skills developing or developed. And you've got a good, you know, a good stroke, whether you're using the rattle can and or the airbrush. By this point, you should know, you should always extend the flow beyond the edges of your model. So, and normally spray with both. I like to spray with the airbrush, depending on what effect I'm after, somewhere between 6 to 12 inches. And then with the rattle can, I like to go between 12 and 18, a separation, so that you can, you know, again, follow through on your, on moving the edge of the paint from the front to the back and from the bottom to the top. So we'll continue this conversation. Hope you're enjoying it, and leave your comments down below, please, and participate. And if you have your own techniques and systems, then, you know, feel free to talk about them or make your own videos. That's what it's all about. Anyway, my friends, stay tuned in for more Cranky Show coming right up.